the counting and follow me, okay? So we'll be going across, okay? So, and get ready. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. One, two, three, four, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. From below. One, two, three. That's it. Very nice. Two, three. That's it. Four. Five.
Six.
Seven.
One, two, three,
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you learn properly, there are huge differences in the velocity, like someone is swinging fast and someone is not, okay? All of us are plus minus the same, we are human beings, there are some things, okay? But the only thing is that some people do better than the others, and what is the whole goal of the training is to utilize the movement the most that we can, okay? There is a huge difference when you do a cut like this and when you do it just the front, okay? So I'm using the shortest route to get to my opponent, okay? If I should thrust, I'm drafting like, and I'm slowing down, okay? But if instead I'm just going forward for my target, this is how I gain the speed, okay? It's not just about being strong, young, fast, beautiful, I don't know, okay? We just need to train well, how to go directly and properly for the marathon. Okay, so now we'll do two more training exercises. Okay, so we'll combine balance, thrust, reach, okay. Okay, so one more time. We'll go probably in three rows, okay? So none will hurt the other. So one more time, I'm going. Advance, thrust, and so we need 185 pounds of mass. It's not just your arms, it's everything. Okay? So, one more time. From here, we'll just do a quick track and boom. Okay? Should be soft landing. Right, the more energy you're giving. Okay, get ready. One. Ready. Two. Three. And some examples of how to work with your opponent. Okay. The other one will be about using very aggressive means of closing up on your opponent. Okay. I'd like to say, I don't know if you compete, if you go to big competitions or whether you do it in your club. I guess most of you do have some experience with sparring. Okay. I compete a lot, and I've observed many things. What fencers do, what they do. One of the, I would say, biggest mistakes everyone does is that they don't have a plan. When people are playing, usually they are just trying to do some random things to hit because they think that it's appropriate. But if we really want to get somewhere from A to point B, we should have a plan. Without a plan, we will fail. But we will fail. But with a plan, we are raising our odds to get a successful game. Okay. For these reasons, I started with simple tactics from the guard at the long point. Okay, think around the long point is like, well, first he talks like there are just these four guards you should be holding. Okay, so there's this from that position. Okay, you have an over ox and fluke and don't do anything else. Okay, but there's also this, you know, like trample. And besides that, there's long point, which is like best is terrific. Make it ready. Okay, so. Long point has got many advantages. Foremost, that when I'm extending, when I'm holding it properly, my opponent will be having hard times to get to me. Okay, since everything I need for a parry, no matter what he does, is just to slightly move my hands in this, let's call it a square. Okay, so even if my opponent was cutting, okay, I'm covered, and from here I can do, of course, a lot of things, or I just can defend myself. Okay. So, the first exercise we will be doing, which is very simple, one of us will assess the role of a coach, okay? The one who will be the coach, who will be in the band at one point, will be giving us signals to attack. Immediately, when my opponent will see that I'm giving him a signal, we will go maybe forward for that, okay? But, when you're doing the thrusting, I know that the typical exercise is to go into ox and grab. Okay, ox is a very, very powerful position, but we don't need to do it unless certain specific criteria are met. Okay, my opponent gives me an opening. Here, I've got a straight way just to my target. Okay, so what we will do is from here, we'll just slightly turn our wrists forward, and we'll grab our opponent into something like a full position extension. Okay? So don't go, if you don't necessarily need, don't go into box. Okay? Because box is like, or should be like, option of last resort. But rather, from here, we'll go just forward. Okay? So, from the time opponent gives us a signal, boom, immediately I go for the target. Okay? Don't forget the thing that we were doing before. So, first, it's the arms. Try extended and then the body follows. Okay? Come on, form up pairs. And because our opponent, when they do thrust, they already have their hands quite up high. So now, if I want to do this, I will need to do this, but this, of course, makes a lot of sense. Okay? So I need to find my targets above the opponent's shoulder. Okay? So, just very small and direct motions. So, make your opponent move into the thrust, turn your arms, and make a thrust into box. Okay? So, remember, this is a controlled situation. You need to be in full control. So, don't be relaxed like this. But try to think. You will not go with the thrust sooner than you will give him a signal. And when he does so, he will be already prepared just to do the forward we can test these orcs, okay? So one more time. I'm ready. Boom. Okay, so just turn your wrists immediately into orcs from here and trust your opponent, okay? You good? Okay, so for instance, now we've got a very simple, let's say, two exercises. If we think about it a bit more, this is something that we may call a tactical approach. So I have an opponent who is standing in one flank point, okay? So first thing that I need to assess is the distance, okay? So depending on everyone has their own means of assessing. So for instance, sometimes when you go just with your arms like this, you know that now I'm in such a distance that if I make a step, I will hit my opponent, okay? So I just do this, I know that the distance is correct, okay? So, and the second thing that I need to do is just to try my opponent's blade, or try him, whether he is the one who is rather defensive type or an offensive type, okay? And this is exactly, I may provoke him. Like, when he responds to my provocations, then I will know what to do. So for instance, like, hey compadre. Okay, you can just provoke him. This is something which is really unsettling, okay? So you get someone, you just approach them, boom, and you make a thrust, okay? If your opponent is not responding, because we, of course, this is not something that you should be doing like for 1 hour, okay? Thrust, okay? If they're, of course, not responding, this is instantly the information for me that I should go with the strike. And this is also approximately the time that it should take, okay? So, if it's like, I immediately go. I won't wait, because if I see that my opponent is not reacting, if he's still, I'm certainly rounding some magic, okay? Immediately I take the initiative and go to the front. Or, if you're rather a defensive type, you may really like, you see there's an opening, okay? When they react, you go for it. Okay, this is it. So, now we're trying also slightly different technique. So, most of the people who you will ever push a sword in your life, most of them, at least in Hima, will react with a counter push. Okay, this is normal, like hey, okay? This is the same like, what is the easiest thing that you may do against someone who's pushing your blade? You may disengage. Okay, so this is exactly something we may try. When I push my opponent, I will just make a small disengagement and come from the other side. Okay? Usually, when I'm trying to force my opponent to do the disengagement, I'm not trying to be static before I do so, like this. But rather, I'm trying to make a false move, like a false approach, okay? I'm making him pain that when I'm going like this, then I'm slow. But immediately, when they push my leg after the opening, I just disengage and make a full thrust towards their chest. Okay? Of course, if the opponent is not reacting to our pressure, boom, immediately make a thrust, okay? So this is not about waiting. I need to assess immediately whether he's strong, whether he's weak, or whether he will push me, okay? In the end, if you, even if you make a mistake of assessing the situation, If you still obey the rules, so for instance, you try to go around and your opponent starts thrusting, if you obey the rules of thrusting and you have a strong position, you may still somewhat turn it around. Okay? So, one more time, I come close, I push it, boom, immediately I go to the front. Okay? Some people, or maybe even you, can have a question whether it is better to thrust into the ox by disengaging or forward to a long point, okay? This really depends on the distance and on the tempo. Usually, if your tempo is right, if you took the initiative from your opponent and you can immediately do it after they push, you will be successful in hitting with the long point, okay? And this is better for us because the more we extend our arms, the faster we will hit, okay? Of course, if you are too close or something happens, you may, of course, just disengage and go into the ox position and run somewhere away from our opponent. Okay? So one more time. We come close, we push our opponent, boom. Immediately, just make a thrust. Okay? Open them, wait until they will push your blade back and then make a forward thrust. Okay, come on. Saying that Durflexon can be done in any direction, so we don't need to limit ourselves just doing it from below, but sometimes if the situation wants it and the opponent pushes, we can go from above. Okay, so now we will do let's say combination. If the opponent pushes, we can just slightly raise the blade and go forward into the thrust. Okay, so it's up to you. You can do it either from below or from above, depending what feels better to you. Okay, of course, be very careful when you do the one from here, just to go a little bit above the opponent's point and then back again. Okay, because if you leave your sword like this, this is an invitation. This is immediately information for my opponent that I am open and that I'm missing the tempo, or not missing, I'm creating a tempo. Okay, so that's why you should be careful and immediately go forward to the thrust. Okay, come on, make a cut. Okay, so a simple, it's okay. So I control, I open, they push, boom, and we hit them. Okay, again, just a very small disengagement. So when they push me back, I'm coming just here, and with a cut, I'm continuing, okay? So go directly to the front. So one more time, I come close, I slightly push, they come back, boom. Immediately, when I feel that the pressure is pushing my sword, immediately I go up and just dive again, okay? It doesn't have to be a strong strike, but if you're following the biomechanics properly, meaning that the body is helping me, this is much, much more powerful than some of the cuts that you're doing from above. Is it okay?
Yeah.
So like I've got, we've collected all the assistants, and we call them the League of Molested and Abused Assistants. Okay? So now you will have your own badge, okay?
Do you want us to use overlaufen with the overrunning?
Yes. Yes, you can do it. Okay? So just slightly, well, this is always for the better if the opponent's sword is here, because it might happen that if you stayed on place, they try to hit you, so it might result in a double hit, okay? So I would rather immediately run through, okay? Come on. In some situations, if I make a bite to my opponent, they will push us back. Okay? If they push us back, immediately we've got a disengagement, which is really easy. Okay? But if you have a more sophisticated opponent, who you know that will do the disengagement for you, again, we can use it to our advantage. Okay? Usually, if you're not sure what character is standing against you, you can always check it. You don't have to go into fight immediately when you start hitting. It's not about okay, or you may, but it's always good to like maybe do it one time. Okay, you see, he does it. So if your opponent does this to you, there's a huge probability that you will do it the second time as well. Okay, so this is for us again very important information. That, okay, boom. Okay. So, one more time.
Fine. We push our opponent. The moment when our opponent leaves the bind is the moment where we just slightly twist forward and immediately go into the strike. Again, most important basis of all attacks, arms first. Arms first, okay? Control the situation. Again, here and from here, just here. Here, here. Okay. This is also a very typical, I would say, maybe the most typical action for rapier fencing. Okay, so in rapier, you just come, and you immediately continue into the second. Okay, so this is also for longsword. One more time, I push, and push the arms forward. Okay, the right ox is really a powerful position. So you don't have to necessarily go too much upward to make a thrust with it. Okay, but rather, you may turn. Rather, you may just push it here to the front. Okay. Well, it's quite useful if you, well, but you can practice this at home. It's quite useful to learn just to keep your point on the place, and every time you're going somewhere with the sword, the tip should ideally not move. It should ideally stand in a position. Okay. This is why sometimes when you go into the ring, then sometimes it may happen that you go like this. Okay, so we're searching the target, and this is very risky because if the opponent pushed me just a little bit, not much, but just a little bit as I go, I would miss my target. Okay, that's why it's much better to try to have the point always on one place and just turn your arms around or your hands up and continue to the strike. Okay, so come on, one more time. I bind, opponent is engaged. In the moment they disengage, I turn my wrists. I turn my hips and I make a forward thrust into the right box. Okay, come on. Which will help us much more to get our opponent into a small trap. Okay, so there's this thing. We may do that if our opponent engages, that we will try to get inside. Okay, so now on purpose we will lift our arms way above and we will try to do something not like a thrust, but rather like a cut. Okay? This is a wonderful action because it might happen that if you do it like really deeply and if your opponent will try to parry you, you will catch them. Okay? You will catch them and they will be trapped.
Is it similar to prom?
I would say more to Shadet.
Shield.
Okay, more to Sturzau. So, from here, you go to here and I'm trying to get a grab like this. It might happen that you will hit him with a thrust or with a shot, but if your opponent manages to push you, we'll just turn our wrists, okay, and hit them with a short edge on their head, which is not. Okay, so one more time. I go here. You see, like magic. One hand is over here, and then
what?
It was here, and then it was there. So fast. Okay, so I go here, I catch them, boom. And then I just turn it and hit them, okay, with the short edge. Slowly. Push. Like this. And then like this. Okay, you will see this is, mechanically speaking, a very easy and a very comfortable technique. Okay, one more time. Push. Boom. Okay, come on. So far we've been dealing with, I don't know, a lot of contact things, we've been dealing with different things, with engagement, with pushing against, the leg, okay, and etc, etc. Sometimes it might happen that your opponent is, well, either an expert or a complete noob, okay? Because there are more similarities between the two extremes than between the middle, okay? So, and your opponent might be either completely unattentive to what you do or a complete cold-blooded bastard, so they know your game and they just won't let you to gain any advantage, okay? If you have problems gaining advantage or if you are not sure that your action will be a successful one, then we may do something which is called, let's say, let's call it locking in, okay? And it's the action when we will just turn our wrists and close the distance, okay? Nothing else, we will just turn our wrists, like this, and close the distance. So now, with that like a million things we can do, Okay? If you wanted, you may hit them with the pommel, you may continue into a thrust, you may start grappling, okay, dum-dum-dum-dum-dum, whatever, okay? So this will be a semi-free exercise, okay? But the first thing, and the most important is, that when we go down, we should just...
Circle.
Just close our wrist, turn it, close down, and keep our opponent here, okay? Usually, the thing which happens after you will manage to do a successful lock is your opponent doing what is most natural for them. So either going like that, which is not problematic because I'm already in a position from which I can do a slice, okay? So immediately go and push their arms. Or a lot of people try just to push against. But if this fails, this is a very bad situation. I have experienced it myself a few times. It's like resistance is futile. Okay, so your opponent blocks you. Okay, so and if I got trouble doing this, you will probably not withstand the other blow. Okay, so now for the opponent. So, but I will show you one nice combination that you may do. You may try. Okay, so I block the opponent, and if they are not going up, you may go like here. Okay, so one more time. I block the opponent, when they push up, I just go, boom, boom.
Dustin didn't move his eyes.
Okay. Clear?
So it's like short edge, long edge, short edge?
Yeah, first one is a, how do you call it, a swipe? Or what?
This one?
If you go from below, how do you call it?
Streichen.
Streichen. Streichen. In German it's streichen, but I mean the English word.
Slashing up.
Yeah, slashing.
I think it's slashing
so
up.
Slashing up, okay. So streichen. So, from here, one more time. I close my opponent. First, I'm going here. Okay.
You're hitting on the first one, right? It's three hits?
Yes.
Okay. Ideally, it's three hits.
So do it slow, though, because you're doing so fast.
I can do it faster.
No.
Okay. I'd love to see it faster.
Okay. So, yeah, here, from here, boom. You see, I'm trying to catch it. It's the same action that we've been doing before, but just from the other side. I'm trying to go here, and when they push us, immediately just boom, boom.
Can we see that? I want to see it at your speed. If you don't mind.
If Dustin doesn't mind.
Good. Okay.
Okay. So the more you push here, or the more resistance you give your opponent, the more he will push you. And sorry. Are you fine? the more momentum you will gain for the next day. Okay?
He's helping you kick his own ass.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And this is what fencing should be about, okay? Yeah. I don't like when people are doing just like, you know, like... Okay? I like when people have a plan, okay? So, I'm not here just to do some fencing. Okay, I'm here to do some fencing, but if I want to win, I need to do it on my own terms. Okay, if the opponent, I will accept the terms of my opponent, I will lose because there are some games in which I'm better and there are some games in which he's better. Okay, so I want to
play your game.
Exactly. Okay, so one more time. So here. Boom. Okay, come on. The tactics for beginners. Okay, so if you're beginning to play swords, or even if you're advanced, these kind of exercises are very beneficial. Because fencing, it doesn't matter if you're fencing from the long point or if you're fencing from your shoulder. Every time you meet your opponent, you are in a bind. And every action you will do is just a result of certain approach, okay? So here, we have these few situations. When the opponent gives us their opening, we should immediately take it, okay? If they push against us, we should immediately leave, either in this way, or in this way, okay? If they take the initiative and thrust against us, we should immediately take the initiative back to us. If then they somehow push us, we should immediately continue, okay? It's still the same exercise. You need to play with your opponent. You need to see how are they reacting. And for this, there is no better device than just to be covered behind one point and try your opponent whether they are weak, strong, and then the most useful action. Okay, good. So,
I was just going to ask if you're specifically pressing the openings on each one of those strikes as a response.
Yes, yeah. Yes, I should be. Okay. It's always, like I said, speed isn't something that you learn by, I don't know, doing thousands of push-ups and doing, I don't know, hours of footwork, but it's mostly about doing, utilizing the movement, okay, going in the most direct way possible. Of course, not very direct, because if I go just a bit, we'll probably end up in a double hit, but just slightly turning our weight, we may gain really fast and strong advantage on the sword. Okay, so thank you. This is the end of the first part. We will do some more exercises with the longsword, so I will show you how to work with initiative from, for instance, from few cutting situations, and then we will have some later. Okay?
Cool.
Okay, so in the first part of the workshop, I was talking about, let's say, basic tactics. Okay? In these basic tactics, we had some situations and we had a very specific set of reactions to these situations. Okay? So I would say this is level one of learning fencing. Level 2 of approaching tactical situation and initiative is learning how to work, how to manage the attack so we can get even better results. Okay? So, there is this thing. When you want to commit a successful attack, you really need to endanger your own. Okay? So, for instance, if I want to do a thrust, and if I want to hit, the more standing with the sword on his shoulder and will be approaching him. Okay? When I feel the distance is correct, I will make an attack with a zwerg towards their head. Okay? Then we will do a second zwerg on the other side. Okay, so
boom.
Yes, so your opponent should probably be very good, right? But in the first zwerg, the most important thing you should do is not just stop here, because this is not the end of the cut, but you should push your arms further, okay? So an action doesn't stop necessarily here, because if I just push it a bit more, I will hit my opponent, and if I'm not going to hit him, at least I will create more pressure for them to parry. Okay, so slowly, something like that. Boom. Okay. So, I'm not just going like two separate strikes, because this is just tempo, tempo, okay? But I'm trying to do it all in one movement, okay? just by pushing your arms a little bit further along his body. Okay? So one more time, you go here. When you stop here, just try to push it. And when then the opponent responds with a parry, you just go and hit it from the other side. Okay? This is the movement, okay? So normally, when you do it in spin, it's not just about this, but rather I'm trying to do it just very strictly. It's one more. It's almost like if you were doing a thrust after the cut, but not like it. I'm just giving additional pressure, okay? I'll do it fast. So here, repeat the first beat. The feeling that your opponent will have is like, oh shit, oh shit, oh shit, I have to parry this. Okay, and this is exactly what we do. Okay, so one more time. I'm striking, it's work. In the strike, I push a bit more and then boom. Immediately, I hit them from the other side. Yes, not just pushing forward, but also raising it. But it really depends on the way how your opponent will land on your blade. Okay, because sometimes you will manage to do the hit. The first one, okay? There is one thing I want to say about the firehouse. If you want to be better at cutting first, you should try to not hold your sword on the pommel, but rather somewhere in between. Or even if you hold the pommel, you should always try to push the pommel a bit behind, so you could hit the opponent behind their sword, okay? I mean, this is very simple thing that you may do, and you will see that you will gain like bonus plus 500 to velocity. Okay? So even when you go from the other side, okay, it's not just cutting, I'm not cutting here. I'm trying to cut here, if you get it. Okay? So even if dusting is trying to cut the other square. Okay. So even if he was trying to cut normally, I wouldn't hit him. But if you try their pairing, okay? And this is also extremely easy if you're fighting with someone and you know that they will push you, so boom, okay? I will just slightly do this. If they parry, they're still, you see? So they're still, all of the situation that will be, and this is really easy with scraps because if you have it just above your head, you can always do this with it, okay? So one more time, slowly. So I come here. Push and pull. Okay, come on. Okay, so in the first part of the workshop, I was talking about, let's say, basic tactics. Okay, in these basic tactics, we had some situations and we had very specific set of reactions to these situations. Okay, so I would say this is level one of learning fencing. Okay, level two of approaching tactical situation and initiative. Is learning how to work, how to manage the attack, so we could get even better results. Okay? So, there is this thing. When you want to commit a successful attack, you really need to endanger your opponent. Okay? So, for instance, if I want to do a thrust, and if I want to hit, the more pushing I am, the more for my opponent, a dangerous situation for my opponent, which he should and must react. Okay? If I don't give my opponent a choice, the only thing they would do is parry my strike, which is also good for me because then I can do a subsequent action. Okay? But in order to do so, I need to do it convincingly and strongly. Okay? there is this. In order to create pressure on your opponent, I'm using this thing. I don't have a trademark name for it, so if you will come up with something, I'll be glad, but I call it micro movements. Okay? It's a very stupid name, but what I mean, usually when you're in a bind, There are two types of, let's say, pressure. Okay, first is just your opponent's pressure, and the other is yours. So either one of you can press the other one, but the more you're pressing on your opponent, the more pressure you're giving to them, the more you're creating a situation for them to parry. Okay. So if I want to force my opponent to do a parry and they're not going to attack me, I need to persuade him that this attack is shit serious, man. Okay. So if I was to thrust at him, you can either, of course, you can do it just like, you know, a simple thrust, but I prefer to do it rather strongly and to push at his blade. Okay. So when I push, or for instance, when you land with a spear in here, okay, and when you are going on the other side, it often happens that your opponent won't parry you. They will just make a counter thrust or something, okay? Because you're not creating pressure. So now we will try the following exercise. Opponent will be standing with a sword on his shoulder and will be approaching me, okay? When I feel the distance is correct, I will make an attack with a sword towards their head, okay? Then we will do a second sword on the other side, okay? So. Yes, so your opponent should probably be very good, right? But in the first square, the most important thing that you should do is not just stop here, because this is not the end of the cut, but you should push your arms further, okay? So an action doesn't stop necessarily here, because if I just push it a bit more, I will hit my opponent. And if I'm not going to hit him, at least I will create more pressure for them to parry. Okay, so slowly, something like that. Boom. Okay. So I'm not just going like two separate strikes, because this is just tempo, tempo. Okay. But I'm trying to do it all in one movement. Okay. And you will see how suddenly this is moving on. Just by pushing your arms a little bit further along his body. Okay? So one more time, you go here. When you stop here, just try to push it. And when then the opponent responds to the parry, just go and hit it from the other side. Okay? Speed. It's not just about this, but rather I'm trying to do it just very strictly. It's one more. It's almost like if you were doing a thrust after the cut, but not like it. I'm just giving additional pressure, okay? I'll do it thrust. So here, hit the first hit. The feeling that your opponent will have is like, oh shit, oh shit, oh shit, I have to parry this. Okay, and this is exactly what we do. Okay, so one more time. I'm striking, it's work. In the strike, I push a bit more, and then, boom, immediately, I hit them from the other side. Yes, not just pushing forward, but also raising it. But it really depends on the way how your opponent will land. Okay, because sometimes you will manage to do the hit the first one, okay? There is one thing I want to say about the firehouse. If you want to be better at cutting first, you should try to not hold your sword on the pommel, but rather somewhere in between. Or even if you hold the pommel, you should always try to push the pommel a bit behind, so you can hit your opponent behind their sword, okay? I mean, this is very simple thing that you may do, and you will see that you will gain like bonus plus 500 to velocity. Okay? So even when you go from the other side, okay, it's not just cutting, I'm not cutting here. I'm trying to cut here, if you get it. Okay? So even if dusting is trying to cut the other square. Okay. So even if he was trying to cut, normally I wouldn't hit him.
5. You move your pawn aggressively forward, then you will be able to get it behind their theory, okay? And this is also extremely easy if you're fighting with someone and you know that they will push you, so move, okay? I will just slightly do this. If they parry, they're still. You see? They're still. Oh, the situation that will be done. This is really easy with squares because if you have it just above your head, you can always do this with it, okay? So one more time, slowly. So I come here, push, and pull. Okay, come on. The exercise is to be the one where we started on the right side and we did the jump. This is exactly the time that we are going to use this in practice, okay? So, someone higher. Have fun.
Yeah, having a blast.
Okay. So this way, Mom.
That's so
are you an organ donor?
Yes.
All right, he's an organ donor. You're good.
Sign your way.
Okay, so this is very useful when your opponent is higher than you. He's just standing in front of you.
Tell me more, Martin.
So because some people are really good, you know, protecting them, and usually when they are holding their swords, you know these people, like, they bite with you, they're like, and then where should I get them? Like, if I go here, they stab, or they bend the other hand, or whatever, okay? So exactly for this kind of people, so it's not a good sword. So if you're a pro, then we may start in here, okay? It will help us to do the jump. So we will start in here. As we are nearing, this is what we want to do, okay? So this is what we want to do. So now, the micro movement, which was rather exaggerated the previous go, will now be included into the jump itself, because as I'm jumping, as I'm flying, it will immediately come into this situation. And from here, I can just do very easily the next time, okay? So I'm here, I go, I can do whatever I want, okay? The first one is important. The first one is important, okay? So just come here, from here, and...
So you're using the force of failure from the backslope?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm just... This serves just the purpose of cleaning the air, okay? So this helps me to get somewhere, and then when I see sword, I can assess now if I want to hit it here, okay? So here,
yeah.
Okay? So this gives you some time. Boom. Okay? Okay, try it.
I've got a mask on.
How much advantage can you gain just by doing one additional thing to your movement, and that is hygiene. Okay. There's an action in Mayer. It's very nice thing to do just because it also utilizes free hygiene change. This is a strange one, okay, but it is just. Okay, wait. So, let us start, for instance, in right box. Okay, the right box. So we will approach our opponent as we So as we approach your opponent, we'll do just this action. Okay. So it means that now here I will just open myself.
Are you doing a glutes how or a clashing cut? Are you striking with your flat or with your edge?
To be honest, I never ever was sure about what's the glutes, how they say, okay? Because the description is extremely vague.
Yeah.
So maybe for some people, in their interpretation, it's a glutes out, but I myself, I'm not confident enough.
So it's more on what you do. You're stepping back.
That's a great
image.
Okay.
It's more like a pro now.
It's more a shield now. Okay, because I'm turning the blade and hitting the opponent with their short edge. Okay, one more time.
That's not a pro.
However, you want to
so
go.
So pro house is flat.
Okay, you can even go from below. So I open myself here, I'm hitting the opponent. Okay.
Okay.
I open myself.
I'm not seeing a video of all of these people doing this because this is going to look insane.
Oh, it's okay. Going to get dubbed over again.
This is, okay. This is, I wouldn't recommend doing this in a tournament. Maybe for fun. But, you know, it's very dangerous.
I'm waiting for the dumb injuries from the jumping one.
Again, this is one of the examples of how to use the glute, okay? Before, you're going from down, upwards, okay? From low, up. Now, it's the opposite, so you're up. Okay, so from here, from upwards, go below. Okay, so we're using the power of our body to make a sudden strike. Okay. That's why we should always try to ease try to find these little ways of how to improve and how to be faster without actually doing anything special. Okay? Just adding a little movement to whatever we do. Okay? So, this will be the end of the monster session. Okay? Hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, I'll leave the time and, after the break here. We'll have like an hour or so for the sparring and stuff. But if you have any questions, extraordinary because certain devices and compositions that he uses are not very common elsewhere, and it gave rise to, let's say, German rapier school, which was dominant in that certain region for another 200 years. Okay. We don't have a lot of time, so I will show you some things which are very specific to him. Okay, some of his really specific techniques which are not from elsewhere, and I think that we will get a grasp of his system rather nice. Okay. Now, all of you have got some experience with the rapier, or not at all? Okay.
Tom, if you're my friend, you'll get me the tripod.
All you need to know is, if you have your rapier in a sheath, okay? If you pull your rapier from the sheath, like this, and your palms point somewhere outside, so this is the first position. First position of the hand, okay? Not like a guard, but the first position of the hand. If you turn your rapier 90 degrees, this is the second position. Or second. Position for rapier is having the weight shifted backwards. But Fabric says that you should rather not shift your weight backwards, rather shift it forward. Okay. The reason for that is very simple. I'm trying to limit my target just for the hand. The more I extend my arm like this, the more I bend my arm. This is the only target that my opponent can get. He can be easily buried. Okay, like as opposed to this, when I'm standing like this, my whole body is a target. Now this is an approach. If something else suits you, it's completely okay. Okay. So, for instance, first guard, which is derived from the first position of the rapier, is formed something like this. So, Fabrice bends a little, okay, and loose. Is bent and the weight is shifted forward. The second position just goes like this. Always hold the off hand somewhere near the target just to be able to do this kind of thing. Okay, so it's really simple. The third position, so the same. I just go like this. I stand like this. The fourth position, the same. Okay, I just slightly bend my body and do it like this. So this is the reason. By many people, Fabrice is hard because they think that when they are fighting Fabrice, they should be like all the time. But this is not true. No. These positions are counter postures that you should do when you're approaching your opponent. And of course, when the fight is starting, you don't have to stand like anything. You know, like, but now we fight. Okay. Let's start with some tricks some cards. Let's start with the very first position. This is something I need someone with a mask, please. This is something most of you will be familiar with. Okay? I want to say that rapier is a very easy weapon. If someone says to you that it's complicated, then you have to learn it, I don't know, for many years. If you're already a good fire, or if you understand the principles, it's just slightly adjusting to different situation. Okay? So, this is a very easy trick. Your opponent stands in front, okay? So, stands like that, okay? We will approach our opponent, bind the blade on the side, okay? We understand inside and outside, right? Okay, so we will bind their blade. If the opponent stays on such a line and is not doing the escape, so only if they stick to my line, immediately return to the first position. You know, winding promotion, this is the same. So you bind the weapon, there you go. This is the only instance in which we use the first position to attack. The problem is that if you wanted to try, I'll just hold it so we go. If you wanted to try to do it, not from the bind, but just like, you know, up the turn, so going inside, probably this would happen. Because the first position goes way high, and the only reasonable choice of using it is when I have the game. Okay. So one more time. Approach your opponent from outside, find it, and turn it, and then transform into the first position. Okay. If you want to, you can do just a lunge with your front foot. Okay. If not, you can also approach your opponent with a few steps. Okay. Like this, or even closer. Okay. It doesn't matter. I mean, fencing is about attacking and hitting. Okay, so maybe you can move aesthetically, but it doesn't matter if you hit your opponent. Okay, so one more time. We stand free. I approach from outside. If they stick to my blade, even if it goes like this, we turn. We turn the blade and we hit our opponent straight on the first. Okay, come on. Something that looks similar to modern flash. Okay? First position is a great advantage that when you really like pushing the when you extend your arm, it is a strong position. So meaning when your opponent starts pushing at it, you are really strong. Okay? So it also if you extend it fully, your body is well hidden behind your legs. Okay? So in some instances, if you have your opponent who is like a lot of people fence like this, okay, so they open themselves or they try to cruise around. If you have an opponent like this, there's nothing easier than just going from here and running them through with just a solid thrust from the first position. Okay, so I say something like a flash, you know, forward, you can, but usually all you just need to do. We will try this a few times. So just when you see the advantage, just lift your arm into the first towards your opponent. Okay?
With weight contact, it doesn't matter.
The whole thing is that when you're holding the first, you've got a great reach in here. So the penetration so you may even go like this, find your opponent was sparing whatever humankind, okay? I usually try to hide my completely the body away from the strike in case something happens. Okay? Another piece of advice. So one more time, go like this. Also the dagger, but like I said, for Fabrice, counter postures is everything. Counter postures doesn't mean that my opponent stands like something, okay? And I'm like this, but rather when I come to the distance from which I can already hit my opponent, then I perform counter postures and attack from him, okay? So for instance, if he did the attack to one with the dagger as well, he would just be like, so the dagger protection. So I'll just cover this opening because this is the one which is. Okay, so. Is it hard? It's just about thinking, okay? Opening. Okay. Opening. Opening. Now let's go to the second fight. So, like I said, the first one, or the attacks in the first position,
are not very
good. One of the reasons is that, for instance, if you want to make something like, after that, the Germans go, if you went to one, there's a big probability that you would lose the point. So, that's why most of the attacks, like this, are done in the second. So now we will try to do the same exercise that we did with the longsword. So I will approach my opponent and I will bind them. After they disengage,
I just turn my base into the second and I make a forward thrust.
So we're coming on the inside line.
Yes. So I come from the inside. Slightly bind my opponent. And they push. I just turn my wrist forward and I hit. Okay? Here, boom. If you find yourself to be too close, this is, you can also do something like this. Okay? It's also a break. Come on. Here comes the first specific guard. I call it a bit wrong. Okay? Instead, open the sword like this. I just go like this, close to my body. Okay? This is rather a weird guy. Okay. But it serves a wonderful purpose of luring an opponent into a trap. Okay? Usually, normally it's used like I do this, so I'm like, hey, hit me. And when the opponent starts, this can be used either offensively or defensively. I like to use it more offensively than defensively because there's just too much risk in this, okay? If you have a quick opponent and you go like this and then immediately take the chance, you might get it. But rather, if you have someone who's standing in the bird, is using an angled bird, this is exactly the position for which we would choose this. Angled, when I say angled, I mean that it's not straight, but there's an angle, okay?
Then what's that? Lower.
The reason for this is
lower
when I straighten it, when I'm immediately
strong position. Most of the time you were like,
so, like here, like that, and boom.
I tried that, it didn't work.
Try to get this thing, this part of the plate, towards somewhere the opponent's table. Okay? It's really easy, you will see. Easy to hit a minute. The second half is really a powerful position. Because when you go from here to now, and you throw like here, you can start immediately.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Just when you stand in the guard, if you have a guy who's standing against you, you should be trying to hide your legs a bit, okay? Because if someone just stands in the second half, the thing is that usually there are two targets primarily for me if I wanted to attack this, okay? First one is here, this is the head, and the second one is of course the feet. But we will try that later. So, this, and okay? If I was having a dagger, exactly the same principle. The dagger replaces the arm. Okay, and when I go for the strike, I'm just trying to, this one will be really nice.
Ow.
Yes, my opponent will take further whatever. So now I will retract
the
words my head to the second up.
Yeah, a little bit.
And I will turn my butt like this. Okay. Something like this. I'm pointing towards my opponent. And if my opponent approaches me, in the moment he comes close that his tip is approximately near mine, okay, or we are starting to cross, and immediately So one more time. Let's try the position. So hold your arms and invert. Pull it towards your hip in the second. Turn it with your body. So now, when the opponent approaches me,
launch into the fourth one.
Okay, so wait, and I'm using strength from second. Okay, it's like I was. And I don't.
My sure,
position is that you don't necessarily understand exactly what it's just principles. I just go away my So let's try.
Do it.
Because you will fail. This card is only defensive. It's only for winning. Okay. It doesn't make sense to approach your opponent like this, you know, because they will get you eventually. The steps, you know, you're completely not completely, but more or less out of balance. It's just for winning. So I can wait in this like for long, and then you want to trust one. But normally you would need. Let's move to the third position, okay? So if you remember, one, two, three. So the first is the most natural one. Okay? So there is this super duper guard that you can use. And something like this. Okay, so again, I'm trying to hide my legs. And I just have my sword up in the air. Okay? This. Let's start with a very basic one. What do you think would be the advantage of bringing your sword?
Your blade's in absence, so he can't engage it.
Exactly. Okay, so my blade is out of his reach. If for some reason my opponent decided to bind my blade, so let's say the first exercise will be that my opponent will be making a thrust on my blade. Okay, so thrust. So we will block it. Like this. We should be doing this ideally at the same time. Okay? Same time, pairing, same time, thrusting. So same time, pairing, same time, thrusting. Okay?
Don't walk up over the middle.
It's the same, okay? So I'm just going to line. Yeah, put it. It's going.
That's a shoot.
But you know, this isn't the primary attack which is done from this position, from this guard. There's one which is like extra super cool, extra working, and it goes like this. Your opponent is standing, let's say. So I approach my opponent like this. I try to from the outside. So when I see that I am already in the game, which I can hit, so from here, so I just go down. So, from here, I'm trying to buy. Nothing else. Still in third, I sort of go down like this. Sorry. You.
Know how to extend your hand?
You don't need to. Is your right hand? Yes. You don't need to, because what I can do is go here. I go. You can.
Let's do more changes.
Yes, but you don't have to. Really? Okay. So, sometimes you can do it like. Oh, sorry. Like
that. That's all sports.
Or you can just run your own.
Should I cut down?
No, I didn't cut.
Yes.
very useful. Maybe because a lot of people don't know. Okay, so when you write out, and this everyone will go like, oh, did you just write it? Okay, so back, simple. So I put my opponent, I come here, I make four. Or you can go down.
Get him. You want to do it?
Of course, this position can be slightly adjusted. This position can be slightly adjusted, so you don't have to like hold it like this. You can also hold it like this. And if you want, you can do also something like this. Okay, so you can cut. This is completely normal. Don't ever listen to people who will tell you like,
Ricker is about thrusting.
No, it's also like, why wouldn't? Of course, I wouldn't probably try to cut it or the opponent hits me. It's a moment, but I mean to make a solid cut to the head. Okay, so I just go back here. If you have the opportunity, you can just boom, go strike your opponent. You just be careful, either deflecting with your head or something. Okay, or if your opponent just has a low guard like this, for instance, boom. Okay. You just from here. Okay. So we can try just for a moment. So all the other opponent. Sort of, you know how hard thingy. So if your opponent is holding like this, the approach, you can just come towards the rapier. Launch or thrust, if they bury, So, let's go to the fourth one. So, Even if it's not that, if you try to synchronize on the strong part of your blade, it's totally okay. If you just manage to do it properly, okay, so the traction will be in this one.
That's right.
Okay. He goes on the other side, and it's like, well, look, very, very, okay? Let's go to the fourth guard. In fourth guard, if you want to assume a strong guard, you can also stand just like with your feet wide apart.
You know what?
Okay?
I still get good position, so I'm happy.
Stand like this, you can also stand like this. So,
yeah, you got me good there.
Just step away from the side here. Go to second.
No one knows here.